I think it's not a surprise to many watching my videos that I'm a fan of PNSO, and not just because of the excellent quality of its sculpts, better paint application that many other mainstream companies don't have, and generally scientifically accurate, or at least reasonable reconstructions. It's also because of its willingness to tackle animals unusual and obscure, which may not pander to mainstream taste. Leviathan was of course the most recent example, and today we have another. This is Aidan, the Cretoxyrhina. This was one of the largest prehistoric sharks and estimated to be up to 8 meters or 26 feet. At 20 centimeters, this model is 1 to 40, which interestingly puts it right smack in the middle of the 1 to 35 most of us like, and the 1 to 45 that PNSOs recently use for its marine animals. Happily, Cretoxyrhina is actually known from very good remains, unlike some other shark that shall remain nameless. Cretoxyrhina mantelli fossils from the Niobrara Formation have preserved not just the teeth, but also the backbones. Now, sharks are cartilaginous, and in general, cartilage doesn't fossilize, which is why we often have only the teeth. In this case, because of the Niobrara Formation's high calcium content, that cartilaginous skeleton calcified into something we can actually see. Cretoxyrhina belongs to lamniformes, and extant lamniform sharks include the great white, the mako, and the basking sharks, and this model follows that general anatomy. Two dorsal fins, an anal fin, and a gill basket of 5 slits. It's countershaded in typical marine animal fashion, but it's a welcome change from the typical black or dark blue. Instead, it's a brownish color here. It does have a bronzy shine, which I like, although it's uniform and missing some of the multi-layered complexity in the dorsalmost aspects that you can see in the release image. Now, you want to know about the seam, of course. Well, here it is. But because it's here following almost the gills, it's not as obvious. Now, a close-up of the shark. You'll see the blunt nose. I like how the countershading boundary has crossed up into the snout here, giving it a nice layered look. You have the large eyes. And of course, those famous teeth. With teeth up to 7 centimeters or 2.8 inches long, with thick enamel, these teeth look like they could pulverize hard material like shells and bones, and it's the reason that Cretoxyrhina has also been called the Ginsu Shark. Now, for those of you too young to know, the Ginsu knives were a product from those early days of infomercials, giving us many of the catchphrases we're now all too familiar with.
Wait, there's much, much more. We also want you to have this 6-in-1 kitchen tool.
Certainly, we have fossil evidence of Cretoxyrhina preying, feeding and biting through mosasaurs, pterosaurs, and even dinosaurs like this hadrosaur here. Remains of animals even included the fish from Hell's Aquarium, Xiphactinus. The teeth here are individually sculpted without overlap, as should be the case, and at this scale, not too much detail can be seen. Unfortunately, they're not as carefully painted as I'd expect, given that this is one of the most iconic features of this shark, so some touch-up will be necessary if you have the skill or money for it. There's no jaw articulation, so there are no discontinuities in the jaw. In fact, I feel that an articulated jaw in fish seems a little forced, and unless there's a specific purpose, for example, to show some unusual mechanics like in the Helicoprion or the Dunkleosteus, there's really no need. Now going down the body, you see the skin of the shark. It's generally smooth with a hint of texturing, as befits a streamlined predator. I really like the color of this and the transition here. Again, I'm really liking this bronzy shine. I just wish it was less uniform throughout. Now very interestingly, coming off the posterior of the pelvic fins here, PNSO has sculpted claspers, an essential male feature that aids in mating. Now, how exactly I won't get into, because that would make this video too long and perhaps too pornographic to be monetized, but it's worth your while to read up on. Very interesting. And finally, the tail, and I'm pleased that it's been reconstructed with the lunate form suggested by Shimada et al. In 2006. Now first, the pre-caudal to caudal vertebrae angle is 45 degrees, which is the maximum possible in modern sharks. Now secondly, these structures here, called the hypochondrial rays, are of different lengths. The anterior and posterior most are short, while those in between are longer. And taken together, it suggests a lunate fin spotted by lamniform sharks, as you see in Isurus, the Mako shark. And these are the fastest sharks in the world, because they use tuniform or tuna-like swimming, where all the sideways movement happens in the tail and the peduncle, which is this region connecting the tail to the main body. This is as opposed to sharks with no tail bend and generally uniform hypochondrial rays, resulting in a tail that is heterocercal, as you see in the smoothhound shark Mustelus or the dogfish shark Squalus. Now this suggests that Cretoxyrhina too was a very high speed swimmer, which would help its status as one of the apex predators of its time. And this is also helpful because while we have an idea of the vertebral column, the actual body shape and outline will have to be inferential. So knowing its close relationship to extant lamniforms, we can model this extinct shark on that bow plan in what's a reasonable hypothesis. As always, we'll end off with some comparisons. First of all, we'll look at the other PNSO shark that I have, the Helicoprion. Here. And for its contemporary enemies slash food, here are the PNSO Tylosaurus. And the deadly Xiphactinus. So that's Aidan the Cretoxyrhina. I have to say it is so refreshing to have another prehistoric shark that isn't Megalodon, which, believe it or not, I was never really interested in. I really like the form of this shark, as well as the paint application, even interesting details like having the claspers. And also the interesting thing is this costs a lot less than PNSO's recent offerings. In fact, it's the same price as many of the figures I got from last year. And I don't see any compromises in quality here, which should be welcome news to all. Now, some other prehistoric sharks I hope that PNSO might tackle in the future would be Hybodus, Scaponorhynchus, and Stethocanthus, the ironing board shark. And given their small size though, they'd definitely not be 1 to 45 or even 1 to 35. For something larger, perhaps the Eugeniodontid Edistus. So that's it for this review. I look forward to hearing your thoughts, especially the shark lovers out there. And I'll see you soon with another review.